Right, welcome to the video, guys. Thought I'd do something different on this one and do a voiceover. I'm turning around to the camera there and saying apologies for not wearing my usual GRP attire, but I was in not so much a rush, but I wanted this doing quickly before the temperatures rocketed up. It was already, as you've just seen on that digital thermometer, 24 degrees, so my measurement of that hardener, which is in that bottle, is measured to absolute perfection. Slightly too much and it's gone off. And if it does go off, you just stop immediately. You don't try, you know, getting another few seconds out of it. It's happened a couple of times over the years, not very often, but it does happen very, very rarely. So, critical amount of hardener going in that. Mixing it up well. Now, the idea behind this flow coat or method of applying it is to get it out of that bucket where there's a good volume of it. You know, there's 5.5 kilos in that pot there. And get it out onto the job without laying it off, which is the smoothing out process. The idea behind that is there's heat building up in it. The minute when you put the hardener in and you start mixing it, it starts to generate heat. So get it out, spread it out to the right, you know, thickness if you like, and then lay it off. Okay, frequently asked question, where am I based? Derby. Ideally placed in the middle of the country, pretty much, to access just about anywhere else in the country. But that doesn't mean I can do a pond, you know, the size of this one. You see what I'm stood in there now, right? You imagine that sort of pond just without the rill section, yeah? That snakes up and off into the distance. It's just not reasonable to expect me to travel to the likes of Kent or Scotland to go into a pond of that size. It's just not, you know, it's not possible as much as I'd like to. And sadly, I don't have a network of GRP guys all over the country, you know, in everybody else's area that I can say, well, you know, phone this guy. I know this guy that does ponds. I just don't know people all over the place, I'm afraid. So just smashing it on, go along the top first because you want to make sure you've covered the top, because when the edge in top, I'm not sure what's going on the top of this actually. The customer probably did tell me, but you want to make sure you come over the edge about 20 mil, something like that. So you've got no fiberglass showing, you know, underneath the copings. Frequently asked question, what's the biggest pond I've ever worked on? Well, there were two. They weren't ponds, they were lakes for a county council in Rotherham at a cemetery. They were huge, something like 50 metres long each. 15 metres wide and about sloping down right to the bottom by about 7 foot deep. Dug out with massive excavators and it was all foam lined and fiberglass. Another frequently asked question, what's the furthest I've been to fiberglass a pond? Barcelona. You don't need me to tell you that's in Spain, but I've been to Barcelona to do one. Furthest place in the UK was in Peterhead in Scotland. If I remember rightly, it was nigh on an 8 or 9 hour drive just to get there. Not something I wish to repeat these days. Wear and tear on the van is just ridiculous. So I'm getting plenty on out of the bucket, doing all the walls, leaving a bit that I can stand in to then hop up onto the rill section and then use my pole to reach down and do the bit that where I'm stood right now. Another frequently asked question, how did I get into fiberglassing? Well, as you know from my sideshow that I run alongside GRP lining services, I work on fish ponds for people, mostly just cleaning them out these days, not building them or renovating them and doing these TV style makeovers that I used to do quite regularly. So I've pretty much always been into ponds, and I had some guy that you, I mean, I'm talking 25 years more ago, that used to fiberglass my ponds, and he had some flowcoat spare left over from a job. You know, he was obviously putting it on like I am, and the spare he'd got in a bucket, he just poured it into the floor of the pond. I said, why have you done that? He said, oh, it's spare. I said, well, the job looks a mess now. He says, oh, it don't matter, it's all underwater. And I'm like, well, you've spoiled the job, it don't look right. You know, you've never done this on a job before. You know, obviously I wasn't doing fiberglassing, I didn't know about it. And as I've always said, leave these things to a professional, because it's not as easy as I make it look in these videos, trust me. You know, I've been doing it a long time. I've done this literally thousands of times now. So I went off into a factory to learn how this stuff works. And they said to me, you know, if you learn how this stuff works, you can go anywhere in the world and make anything with it. And they were absolutely right, because I have done so. So the answer to the question is pretty much most of my work in life now, or more of my work in life than, you know, doing anything else. Should have something like 15 or 20 minutes life in that flow coat at these temperatures. And I'm here, I'm not able to smash large areas out. I've got to work on, you know, what is not even 6 inches of wall there, and then probably a metre. Oh, it's a metre wide all told from the top of the wall in the rill to the other side of the top of the wall. So I'm literally smashing out a square meter at a time, where normally you'd see me in a koi pond that's 5 foot deep doing like 2.5 to 3 meters of wall at a time, getting the flow coat out on, ready to lay it off with the rollers. So all the time on this job now, that, and I'm really mindful of how fast this is going to set in these temperatures. I'm still trying to get it on as quickly as possible without, you know, making a mess of it and missing any. Richard, my absolutely fantastic assistant, Richard, has been absolutely brilliant for me this year. I can't thank him enough for everything he's done. He's holding the camera static at where he stood, so he's not following me around and potentially dropping or kicking dirt into the job and contaminating it. Just have a quick look at that cover. This is first thing in the morning. It's about 9 o'clock, 24 degrees, and the night before, we lifted the side up to the right. On the right-hand side of the screen, you can see the cover has been opened. I think we left the fan running as well, and that's to try and prevent any condensation building up on the metal poles that hold that thing together. And that then subsequently comes dripping down on you. So every effort with these, you know, sometimes with these covers is made, but then you can get condensation build up on the metal poles that rains down on you. So even a cover open like that lets that heat out. Not that it cooled down much, it was like 20 degrees constantly, even through the night. You can see my tools in the buckets, and the tin of flow coat and the tools are this side of the pond on the right hand side of the screen, rather than, we did store them up the top in the left hand corner of what you're looking at right now. but we've brought them all forward, ready to go back into the van, so we haven't got to step over the flowcoat to get the tools back once, twice, so we don't contaminate the flowcoat that I'm putting down now. So there is a little bit more thinking than you might think actually, you know, goes into doing a job like this. Sometimes you'll have the builder will have put, you know, brand new copings down or brand new slabs, and we will do everything we can then to protect it. We'll use some sheets of Proplex, thanks to Steve Wainwright for that tip. Awesome material that is for protecting floors and things. Another frequently asked question. How much do you charge per square metre, mate? Well, I will let this be known. I actually despise being called mate. I don't know what it is. I just don't like it. And I don't charge by the square metre. You know, this particular job here, it's unique, it's individual, yeah. The distance away from my base in Derby, that's unique to this job, yeah. Everything is priced relative to the size of the pond, the distance away from me, any technical aspects of it, whether I'm doing overnighters, staying in my van for one night, possibly 3, 4, or 5 nights. There will be a little bit of flow coat left over, probably only about 1.5 inches in the bottom of the bucket. But I do like to have more rather than have to, you know, dispense or decant some more from the tin into either a fresh pot or, if I possibly could, you know, into the bucket that I'm already using, bearing in mind there's a lot of heat generated and it'll start setting anything new that you put in it straight away. There was a skip on the customer's drive and I did ask politely if I can put that in the skip, just that one bucket, because the stench that comes off it in the confined space of a van, it's really, really nasty, and you don't want to be driving about with the stench of that cooking in the back of the van. There's a little stepping stone at the top of that job, and I haven't flow coated the top of it because he wants to put like a slab on that will be mortared down. So rather than try and bond mortar to the incredibly smooth waxy surface that flow coat is, I've just omitted the flow coat from the top, which is above water level anyway. And at the very end there's a little sump kind of chamber with a return pipe at the end of it, a little bit deeper than that channel that I'm working on. It was about 2 feet square, something like that, and about 15 inches deep. Interesting little job to work on. Another frequently asked question, what's my lead time? I will always be booked up a minimum of at least 2 weeks in advance. This year, 2020, has been unprecedented in demand for what I do, to the point where I can barely cope with all the jobs that I've got booked in. I cannot physically do this 5 days a week. It's too physically demanding, the driving's too much. So I'm having to be selective on what jobs I take on, and in particular, you know, distance jobs. I'm trying to cut those down somewhat now. I had a bit of a supply issue with the foam as well. That didn't help. All this, all this virus thing going on has meant a shortage on foam, but now I'm back on track as of the 20, 6th, 27th date, whatever date this is uploaded, I am back on track now with 400 square metres of foam now in stock. So all I need now is the stamina to get back out there and get grafting again. Little show off of the job, let's little look at it. I think I'm explaining about the stepping stone there. That'll look absolutely fantastic, you know, when it's all finished and all slabbed up. It'll be a real asset to the garden, that. It's going to be filled with pebbles and stones, rather than just being able to see that raw fiberglass. It'll be a nice feature. And thanks for the customer for trusting me to do it. Goodbye from me, Richard. Cheers.